What we're going to do today is break the session probably up into two, and the break will be about 3 o'clock or so. The first part of the day, what I'd like to do is answer specifically questions to do with sexuality and sex and those kind of questions. The second part of the day, I would like to open it up to sort of a more general questions that may have arisen from our discussion yesterday that you may have. So we'll do that. But before I start with the questions, I just wanted to say that obviously I have not resolved my own sexual injuries yet. And so therefore, my answers to you are not going to be based around my own personal experiences, aside from the personal experiences I can remember prior to my incarnation this time. So what I'm trying to do there basically is to give you God's perspective on sex and sexuality, even though I myself am not yet 100% in that particular perspective myself. So if you can bear that in mind, that Mary and my relationship still has work to occur in the sex and sexuality area, and don't assume that I then automatically know how to resolve all of these other issues, aside from the fact that I do understand and feel quite strongly what God's truth is on the matter. And that's the things that I've remembered. So today, in your questions, if you can keep that in mind, that would be really lovely. And also, if you can keep in mind too that myself and Mary are working through these issues as well. So one of the reasons why I wanted to have this discussion with you is because we have been working through these issues, and they seem quite big issues in terms of our relationship with each other and our relationship with God. And so it was important to bring up these issues too for yourselves so that you can look at these issues in your own life as well, in terms of concentrating on your relationship with God and how this issue of sex and sexuality and love all relate to that relationship with God. So if we can bear that in mind today, that would be great. So what I would like to do today is just put it straight out there open, who would like to ask some questions. But remember I said yesterday that I'd like you to come up into the hot seat and ask the question. So if no one feels brave enough, we're going to have a very short session. So I thought perhaps I could start with one of my issues. How's that sound? Many people I've found who have been sexually abused in the past have this particular injury that I also have. And it's an injury where you actually desire the other person so much that you give everything you possibly can give to the other person, but because of your own law of attraction, they don't give everything they could possibly give to you. And in regard to the sexual injuries, there is a deep feeling inside of me at times of a real sexual neediness that really comes from this feeling that if I'm not loved sexually, then it means I'm not loved at all. And of course, someone loving you sexually is a part of your complete development. This injury, for most people, comes from their childhood where both parents or one parent doesn't love themselves sexually and has completely embroiled themselves, if you like, in the other person's life, completely submitted to the other person in a sexual way, but does not have any concept of love of self in the relationship. So my big issue myself is dealing with this issue of not loving myself sexually, but actually loving the other person and expecting, in fact, nothing at all. And not that you will expect, when you're at one with God, of course, you won't expect anything from someone else. But there's this feeling in me of expecting the same in return. And that causes me then to go through lots of grief when I don't receive the same in return. So how many of you have experienced that kind of feeling? Yeah, so quite a lot. So it's a really big problem, I suppose you could say, in sexual relationships. And what I've had to do working through it is I've had to deal with a lot of grief about how I perceive myself. In terms of how I perceive my own body and my own feelings of not loving my own body, but also deep feelings of not shame, but deep feelings of unworthiness about the sexual relationship. Feeling that the feeling inside of me is that the woman that I love will never be able to love me sexually. That's the feeling that I have. And so no matter, there are other women I know that if I loved them, they'd love me sexually, but it's always this feeling in me that the woman I choose will not do that. The woman I love will not do that. And ironically, that's generally what's happened, of course, because of the law of attraction. I still haven't got to the bottom of that feeling. So there are times when there's feelings that Mary has that triggers me, and I just feel this terrible, overwhelming feeling of, like, I'm never going to be loved sexually, I'm never going to be desired sexually. And because that's such a core injury within me, I then feel, well, I'm never going to be desired at all. And I go down that track of feeling that emotionally, feeling like, in the end, like, no matter what I do, no matter what kind of person I become, and no matter how handsome I look, or no matter how good I get my body to look, that she's just not going to want me anyway. So it's just this terrible feeling of just not being wanted by the person that I love. And then there's this temptation at times to actually get into anger with that. Do you know what I mean? Like, to feel angry with the other person. Why can't you love me? Why can't you? So if any of you get into this trap of going to the other person, why can't you do whatever, straight away you're getting away from your own situation, your own emotions. And so when I notice myself doing that, I always try to kick back into, all right, there's something going on within me, what's happening within me to cause me to feel so bad, to feel that bad. Over a period of about 3 months, I cried for 4 or 5 hours a day on this matter. And I got eventually down to some really basic core emotions. And one of them was this just terrible feeling inside of me that I was nothing. And if a person was distant from me sexually, that meant that they felt I was nothing. And all that was doing was triggering this emotion inside of me that I am nothing. And so once I got to the core of that, things started changing for me quite a lot in terms of feeling that emotion and working through that emotion. But I've still got some of the issues there, and I can feel some of it is about, throughout my life in the last 2,000 years, there's been a lot of projections of me from women about being the ideal man. But it's a lot of those projections have been sexual in nature, which I've always repelled. But once I reincarnated, this feeling was very, very strong. And I used to have problems even, like, if I was walking along the beach or down along a frontage where, like, you know how you have streets, well, where I grew up in Adelaide, you have these streets down by the beach that where there's pubs all the way along the street sort of thing, and then the beach in front and things like that. And so... if I walked along the beach in front of the pubs and there are any women there projecting sexually, I would just, like, freeze, and I'd have to go get away from that. I'd just have to leave that because I just felt so stressed out and panicked by those projections. And so there's a lot of things involved in this particular injury for me that I'm still working through. What it's done for me is it's meant that I have a tendency to give everything of myself to the other person, and also in the same breath, hoping that they will do the same with me, which of course they never do, and that then triggers the emotion. So this emotion that I've given all of myself, but they don't want to give all of themselves to me because of who I am. So it always gets back for me down to this issue of, it's because of who I am that they don't want to do that, but that my partner doesn't want to do that. And it gets back to, for me, it gets back to the fact that, and trust me, if you're Jesus, nobody wants you in, because that's the feeling I have, is that everyone has sort of set me up to be this virginal male who doesn't want sex, who doesn't want any sexual attention, and they equate pure with no sexuality, and there's lots and lots of those kind of projections, and that in itself has created inside of me lots of emotions about in my response to that, that have caused me to detune a lot from other people's projections of me. So the truth is, I don't even notice now, and I should say I didn't notice all the time growing up any person's sexual projection at me. So my mother would often say to me something like, "Oh, that girl was really interested in you," and I'd say, "What? Like, nah," you know, and I just couldn't connect with that at all. And it's only been until I was started opening up emotionally about 11 years ago or so, that I started to even notice somebody even projecting that emotion at me. Before then, I was so detuned from it that I wouldn't even connect with it at all. And so I'm still, like I said, I'm still working through the injury. The injury affects me sexually in the sense that I want to give all the time sexually, but I don't want to receive very much. And so, and my law of attraction, of course, is that the woman generally that I'm with doesn't want to give to me very much either, because of that law of attraction. And so, so in my life sexually, what's happened for me is that I've given a lot, but not received very much sexually. And in particular, the feeling that I'm looking at from the woman is this feeling of complete love. So it always gets back for me down to this loss, this terrible feeling of a loss of my soulmate, like this loss of my soulmate love, and that feeling of loss, the feeling of loss of her, also has another feeling associated with it of feeling like I did something wrong to lose her, like because of a choice that I made, I lost her and I'm never going to get her back. Is the feeling that I have, and so that feeling is one of the deepest emotions underneath this emotion that's driving me sexually. And so I'm still trying to allow myself to connect to that emotion, and that's why there's a movie called The Notebook. Any of you seen that?
Yes.
I've watched it 19 times now. The first time I watched it, it took me about a week and a half to watch, because what I do when I watch a movie is, as soon as something triggers me, I stop the movie and I go off and process. I've dropped out. That's because there's no more battery, I don't think. Okay, we're back in the air, I think. Wow, that's a fair bit louder. Yeah, so as you can see, the problem was I'm not receiving, not allowing myself to receive. And so sexually, the women with me generally have been pretty happy, but I've often felt quite unfulfilled. And the core emotion underneath that is this terrible feeling that I've actually done something wrong to deserve that. And so that's one of the emotions that I'm working through. There you go, I've said something about me. Who's coming up to say something about me? Who wants to come up? Come on.
Yes.
This is how they do.
This is my first time, and so I went through a lot of shame and unworthiness last night, because I had made the intention that I would get up here and speak.
Awesome. So give.
Peter, I did the screen of my mind.
You'll be right.
My question was about chemistry.
Yep.
I want to know whether chemistry is a good indication of meeting your soulmate, or whether it's an indication of you meeting somebody who has matching childhood injuries?
Good question. You don't have to stay up here for the answer.
Oh, good.
Awesome, I did it!
See, all of that was just to help you with this feeling that you had last night. This is why I do these things. All right, let's look at chemistry. Most people assume that the soulmate connection means that there will be an instant sexual chemistry. And that is not true. The soulmate connection is not based on just sexual chemistry. The soulmate connection is based on lots and lots of different factors within the soul. If you have an instant sexual chemistry with somebody, it's possible that that person is your soulmate. But it's also possible the person isn't your soulmate. And that's why it's important not to judge a soulmate connection on sexual chemistry. Let's look at what's happening in sexual chemistry. Got the male, let's say in your case, you're a heterosexual leanings in your soul, are you not?
Yes.
Okay. So you got the male and the female. Remember I've talked about injuries at the different chakra locations. So you've got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Primary chakras. Remember the chakra locations are meridian points for the crossover of energy. Now, if we now translate all of that from the metaphysical to the soul-based explanation, the chakra points are areas where emotions flow out of you and into you. Does that make sense? They're major vortexes where emotions flow into you and out of you. So, of course, the male has the... And by the way, I'm drawing 7 chakra points because that's what's traditionally thought of as as having all of your chakras open is traditionally thought of as being the best possible state of being, if you like, in terms of here on earth or even in the spirit world. The truth actually is when you're on the divine path, your chakras all change anyway. And once you enter in a one condition with God, you have more chakras than what you have if you don't receive divine love. So the process of receiving divine love actually transforms the soul so much that the meridian points of energy also transform. But if we just take it from what many of us have already learned about and understood, let's say there is the seven chakra points. So we've got the same for our lady. 3, 4, heart area, 5, throat area, 6, the third eye area, 7 crown. Now, for every single person on earth, we all have different types of injuries, different types of emotional injuries. Now remember these chakras, they open to various degrees and in various ways, and remember they're not only on the front of you, they're also at the back, at the rear of you. So these are chakra energy points that flow all around you and create an envelope, if you like, around you. Now, these energy points are emotions. So what controls the chakras is emotions. So that's why you can go and lay on the table and get your chakras all cleared, and then a half an hour later, one or two of them or three of them be blocked again. And the reason why is because the emotion that's blocking that location in an energetic way, the emotion blocking the location just causes that energy center to close down or invert. It can invert as well. So some of these energy points will flow out under normal circumstances, but we have them flowing in. And remember, if you hold a pendulum over the top of these points, sometimes you have an anti-clockwise rotation rather than a clockwise rotation. And sometimes they get disturbances in them through the different emotions. And so you'll have a pendulum doing figure eights or even figure all sorts of strange shapes over the top of the chakra rather than running in a nice circular clockwise fashion. Now when they're running in a nice circular clockwise fashion, it means your spirit body is functioning the best it possible can function at that moment. It doesn't mean you're dealing with your emotions. And it doesn't mean that you don't have emotions to deal with. It just means in that moment, things are flowing. As soon as you begin to deal with any emotions, certain chakras will close down, certain chakras will open up. The key in your own development is to not worry about that. Now, if you're on a natural love path, you worry about that all the time. And that's what a lot of spirits in the spirit world on the natural love path, they're always looking at a person's chakras. No, that's blocked, we've got to clear that for you. No, that's blocked, no, we've got to clear that for you. Whereas on the divine love path, the focus is more along the lines, of what emotion is causing that to block. What's the cause of this blockage that's happening within you? So bearing in mind that these chakras being open all have causes associated with them as to why they're open or closed. And all of the causes are emotional. You follow me? Now that's a bit of a background. Now, let's say the male has certain emotional things shut down. For instance, let's say the male, right from the time he was born, was taught by his mother or his father or both that men are better than women. Now this is a common belief, right? Even on Earth today, in many of the Eastern philosophies and Eastern countries and some of the third world countries, there is this common belief still that having the man, you know, being born a man is the best possible gender that you can be born. And being born a female is like a curse, even, right, for many of them. And this often is engendered by both the male and the mother and the father. Both the father and the mother, the male and the female parents are engendering this same emotion in the man. So there's a common, and I don't mean to offend any Italians, but there's a common thing like an Italian mama always loves her sons, right? Right, always looks after her sons, and quite often, by the time they're 30, they're still expecting to go home and have a meal with mama anytime. She'll have it ready for her anytime they want, you know, that kind of thing. And that is a continuation of that injury. So let's say this male has that injury. He is not going to connect sexually to a woman who doesn't like that injury. Because he has this viewpoint that he's better than a woman. The only type of women that he's going to connect to is women who feel that they're worse than him. Does that make sense? And so her sympathetic emotion will need to be. So let's say his chakra here, it'd be second chakra, opposite direction. Right? All to do with masculine worthiness. So he's a he-man, right? He's one of these alpha males, right? And she will have to feel the opposite in that chakra area. And what will happen is when that happens, energy will flow between them. Now, when energy flows, it also opens up different parts of your own energy system. And remember, when I'm talking energy, we're talking emotion. Once the emotion starts flowing, that has the habit of opening up sexual desire. So actually, an injury-based emotion can open up your sexual desire. Now, in her and him, he will be attracted to this woman. She has little self-worth as a woman, that she has this viewpoint that women are lesser than men, that I need this alpha male to make me feel powerful, I need this alpha male maybe for security or whatever, and he views himself, oh, I'm powerful, you know, I'm the man, you know, and he has all those kind of feelings in him, and she will be sexually attracted to him. Doesn't matter what's happening in her head. In her head she might think these kind of men are just, you know, they're not very nice. In her head she might think that, but she's going to be attracted to him sexually. So in her head she might want a nice man who's going to treat her nice, and you know, but in her emotion she wants a bad boy, you know, that's the kind of emotion that's driving her. Now that injury causes an unlocking of the energetic pathways in your spiritual body, and because of that there's also the unlocking of the soul's emotional response, and now the soul is responding to having an attraction, which we now call chemistry, right? I feel a certain chemistry with this person. Now, if it's only happening at one chakra level, then the chemistry is not strong. But if it's happening at two or three or four chakras, where the chemistry is very much matched with the type of emotions that are flowing between the two, now the chemistry is going to be almost overwhelming. And they might not be soulmates. Does that make sense to everyone? So just because a person is your soulmate, it doesn't mean that you're going to start off with perfect chemistry. And if a person starts off with perfect chemistry, it doesn't mean that that person is your soulmate. All it means is that right at this moment, the types of injuries that I have and the types of injuries that my partner has that I've got chemistry with happen to be compatible with each other. Does that make sense? So when I first met Mary, Mary did not feel the chemistry towards me. Would you say that's pretty fair? It waxed and waned. So sometimes she felt something for me, other times she not. The thing that shut down any chemistry that we felt together was that Mary had some deep fears soon after meeting me that started coming up. The major one was I was saying that I'm Jesus. Right? Trust me, that's not a good opening line. And because I was in truth, of course I had to say it. But, you know, that caused her to kick into some fear and anger. Now, fear and anger stop any type of sexual response. So if I'm in fear or in anger, and this will happen in any of your sexual lives, if you find yourself closing down in your sexual response, it will usually be related to those two emotions, a capping emotion of fear and anger. So whenever Mary felt anger towards me or felt afraid of what I was saying, straight away there was no sexual response. There was no sexual chemistry. Now, of course, I'm not afraid of Mary. I'm pretty happy she's Mary Magdalene. And I'm not afraid of her, so I didn't feel that. But I did feel the whole shutdown that Mary's had towards me at times. So there was one time, you don't mind me bringing this up, it's too late now. There was one time where I went out to dinner with Mary and she said, I have no attraction for you whatsoever. No physical attraction for you whatsoever. So I went home and cried most of the night in a motel room after that. But that was my law of attraction, obviously, too. So I had to work through that emotion. But the reason why she was feeling that at that time was that she was very, very frightened about what being with me would mean. Right? And fear stops sexual attraction. So when you have chemistry with somebody, it can be very misleading. Very misleading. And this is why it's so important to actually start dealing with everything at the emotional level rather than assuming that this chemistry means we're soulmates. Right? And it's fine to enter relationships where you have chemistry, but it's very important to be aware that most chemistry at the beginning happens to be due to emotional injuries that are compatible and so strongly compatible with each other that this emotion of overwhelming emotion flows through you, which actually causes a rush of sexual energy to flow through you as well. So it opens up the sexual pathways as well in your soul, which then open up sexual pathways in your spirit body and your material body. So does that make sense what's going on there? So if you feel you have chemistry with somebody, that's fine, feel the chemistry, but understand that this chemistry can often be a deep emotional scars within yourself and them that are very compatible with each other. And this is why some people finish up marrying people intellectually that they feel are going to be a good husband or a good wife, but there is no sexual chemistry. And quite often we're looking for things at an intellectual level with our relationships rather than an emotional level with our relationships. Conversely, sometimes we have people who are always looking at things from an emotional level, and so their sexual chemistry with their partner waxes and wanes within the space of a day, or a week, or a month. And so they really feel into the person within the first few weeks. 2 weeks later, the emotion's been worked through by one of them, no longer feel attracted. And so they feel, oh, I'm not attracted to you anymore, I don't know why, but I've got to move on. And off they go to another person. Does that make sense? And this is why things change so rapidly, is because that's our emotions that have control of those things. Right? And it's our emotional injuries generally that have control of those things.
Adrian,
I'm just noting a bit as well.
Scary.
It's not scary, you're
Well, yeah, I've known a man for a bit, and
I wasn't really that attracted to him, but about a month ago we had really prolonged eye contact when this group together. And when I went home, something just, all these things opened inside of me, like, you know, my heart and sexual responses, and it was just so strong that my question is following on from before, you know, is that compatible injuries or is it a soulmate connection?
You don't need to stay here either.
Yeah.
A good question. It's a very good question related, of course. The fact that you weren't instantly attracted to this man is a strong indicator that it's not to do with compatible injuries. If it's compatible injuries, generally you are instantly attracted. You feel some kind of instant attraction with a person. So, now mind you, that person could be your soulmate, because you could meet your soulmate at any time, and they could have a series of compatible injuries with your interests. So I'm not saying they might not be your soulmate. But what I'm saying is the relationship will be very damaging unless both of you are really focusing on dealing with the emotions. In that case that you mentioned, if you haven't had that instant attraction from the moment you met, then it's highly likely, actually, that this is going to be a more pure type of relationship if you now have an attraction. And the reason why that is that the process of looking into his eyes obviously had the effect of opening up things inside of you that you couldn't see before. Does that make sense? Which you can now see. You're feeling a change.
I've got critical in my intellect about
it. You're critical in your intellect about it, yeah. But here you're feeling something different. You're feeling like, what's going on? And this is often the feeling you have when you meet your soulmate, actually. Right? So I'm not saying he is your soulmate. What I'm saying is often the feeling you have when you meet your soulmate is intellectually you've got all these criticisms. But emotionally, you feel drawn to this person and you don't understand why. The process of looking into a person's eyes often has the effect of opening up you emotionally because you're now looking at things, instead of looking at things from a physical perspective, you're starting to feel their soul. You're starting to feel them at the soul level. And a soulmate connection is all about soul level connection. So I've found on many occasions that, like, I know certain people are soulmates, they've met each other, they're not physically attracted to each other, but I know if they spent time in each other's company and just spent time looking at each other from a soul perspective, that they would rapidly connect with each other. So the key for you now is to just explore, like, try to get rid of the criticisms in your head. The criticisms in your head are all the programs that you've been told from your past about what your ideal man is.
Does that make sense?
And so what we often do in our head is we set up for ourselves a list of requirements in our ideal partner. And that is not the way to find a soulmate, generally. Unless those list of requirements are soul-based requirements and not intellectual requirements. So for example, a soul-based requirement, that the person is a truthful person. Now, the problem is your soulmate could have an injury where his mother beat the truth out of him senselessly, and any woman that he connects with, he's going to lie to all the time. Now, how are you going to know that particular man's your soulmate? You're not going to if you have this intellectual requirement that your soulmate speaks the truth all the time. Does that make sense? So you can make these intellectual lists all you like, but in the end it's not going to draw you to your soulmate. What will draw you to your soulmate is you connecting, and this is what you've been doing over last year, you've been starting to connect with emotions about the opposite gender, haven't you? Like, you started to bring up stuff within yourself, and I can feel the changes in you towards men. Like, you have changed towards men over the past year. So in that process of changing towards men, that now makes you much, much more open to actually recognising who your soulmate may be. The process of looking at someone in their eyes gets rid of all of this physical stuff and starts concentrating just on the soul-based qualities of the person. You start feeling their soul. And that's a much more powerful process. And it's also the way in which you'll find who your soulmate is. So when I first met Mary, I could feel her soul. And it wasn't anything to do with how she looked. It was about the feelings that I could feel within her that matched. I could feel there some kind of match between myself and her. And there was a lot of other things going on, of course, but this caused huge turmoil inside of me. So much turmoil that I couldn't speak to her in a very, what do you say when you put things together well?
Coherent.
Yes. That's it. You know, I couldn't speak to her in a very coherent manner at all, because I was just, there was so much going on inside of me emotionally just in meeting her that she had no awareness of, but I could feel all these things going on. So my suggestion is to start looking at all of those lists that you have in your mind and start dissecting them as injuries. Allow them to see these lists of things as injuries. And start opening yourself up to your soulmate could be any single person that you meet. And the more you deal with your intergender emotions, the way you feel about yourself as a woman and the way you feel about men, the more stronger your attraction for your soulmate will become. And that attraction for your soulmate will actually draw your soulmate into your life, whether they like it or not. Right? They will meet you at some point then. And if you are open enough emotionally, rather than having a list of things intellectually of what you require, you will be able to recognize them. You may not feel chemistry with them when you first meet them because of the emotional injuries that you have. And the chemistry may take time to build as each of you work through different injuries. But you will feel a deeper level soul connection. And that deeper level soul connection will eventually drive all of the sexual chemistry you have between you. So you'll find the sexual chemistry will grow. So I've seen soulmates meet each other and just say, I don't feel anything for you. In the spirit world, I've seen that happen, where a person has been taken to another person, said, oh, here's your soulmate. This is the person God designed to be with you, you know. They take one look at him and go, nah, it's not my soulmate. Yeah, it's not what I expect, it's not what I want, and off they go. Have relationships with others even, because you can obviously have relationships in the spirit world. And then they come back at some time in the future realizing, oh, that person was my soulmate, actually.
Yeah, he doesn't feel that much towards me.
Yeah. He doesn't feel that much towards you, do you?
No.
What will happen if he is your soulmate, what will happen is as you deal with more and more of your intergender injuries, he will just not be able to help himself. Yeah, so if he's your soulmate, he'll just be drawn back, you know. He just won't be able to help himself. And he won't even understand why half the time he'll say, oh, she's not what I want either, but, you know, I just feel compelled. And that's very much that happens between soulmates, just feel compelled.
Yeah, that's not.
Yeah.
Understand.
Yeah. So the truth is, you started off without the chemistry, and it's only through a soul connection that any turmoil began in you, which means that there's a high likelihood that any relationship you may have with this man is going to be much more sort of healing relationship, even if he's not your soulmate, than any other relationship we've had which has been based on more of an instant chemistry. Because instant chemistry generally indicates an underlying emotional condition which is compatible. Right.
More of a concern as to why, but it's a bit loud.
No,
it's not. It's a bit embarrassing.
Feeling embarrassed. Don't regret. That's part of the embarrassment.
As to why, out of 10 years, I've only had one 3-month relationship with a male.
Yep.
We ended it because I could see that I was playing my stuff out which was doing to please other people. And the more I gave, the more he took. And I knew that that was not right.
Yep.
So we talked about it and finished it. And ever since then, I mean, it's not that I do not go out, because I do. Mm-hmm. And no one asks me out. Mm-hmm. And...
do you ask anybody out?
No.
Okay.
And there are reasons why.
What's the reason?
Rejection.
Fear of rejection?
Fear of rejection.
Yeah.
But then there was one night I was at the RSL and I was having some fun dancing. So I danced with this man and it was wonderful, the music. And then he went up to the bar, got a drink, and this other man came and asked me for a dance. So we went up for a dance, they came back. And then the other man came back from the bar, and here they are both standing, right, standing, and I'm sitting.
And fighting over you.
And the first thing that came to my mind was, I looked up and I says, if you're both after sex, I don't do it, so you might as well leave.
That's laying it down.
Anyway, 1 meter away. And the other one stayed.
Yeah.
And he remained a friend for 2-3 years. Mm-hmm. And the only reason we're not is because he's travelling.
Yeah.
And anyway, that man that walked away, he came back to me and he says, I admire you for that, because that's what I was after.
Yes.
Because I have had lots of feelings that men are, because I was taught that men were only after one thing. So I've been very,
what's the confusion?
I must have listened to what my mother said.
Definitely, yeah.
But it hasn't been good.
No.
It's been lonely.
Exactly. So how is your heart closed down?
How?
Yeah.
Or why?
How?
How?
Yeah.
How was it shut down?
You can answer why if you want to answer why.
Well, why it shut down is because why is it shut down? Because men only hurt me. Men are never there for me, and when they are, the bastards. That's right.
You remember that?
I was told.
You remember that?
20 years ago, that's what I was doing.
Okay, and that emotion remains unhealed in you.
Yeah.
So the only men that you're going to probably attract are men who reflect that emotion at you.
Mm-hmm.
Does that make sense?
Yes.
So the danger for you entering into sexual encounters is the kind of men who you're going to attract are these kind of men who finish up being bastards and only let you down.
However, it is changing, honey. Because I've been massaging on and off for 5 years.
Yeah.
The first three, I couldn't do a whole year. I'd have to stop after 6 months because
yeah.
I was so depleted inside and worn out from
giving
their sexual stuff,
mm-hmm.
and I couldn't handle it, so I'd stop massaging, go and get a conventional job.
Yeah.
But what I've managed to do now is work through my own sexuality issues,
mm-hmm.
and I've done it for, I'm in my second year now,
mm-hmm.
but no one still asks me out.
So do you feel you have worked through your sexual issues? So you're telling
me
you're telling me you've worked through your sexual issues, but if you're not attracting something completely different, then you can't have worked through your sexual
not
issues.
Not all of them, no.
Does that make sense?
Yes.
And one of the biggest issues that you have are this underlying belief about men, that men are basically bastards who are going to let you down. And all they want is sex from you anyway, which you're not putting out.
No.
Right. Now, that's the core emotion that needs to be healed.
Mm.
And without that emotion being healed, what you're going to do is attract men who are going to be the kind of men who want to use you sexually.
I understand. And why I've managed to do over a year of massaging is because there are some beautiful, beautiful men out there. Mm-hmm. And I've had to, well, not had to, but I've, I mean, I would have 30 men a week on my massage table. And I would be getting perhaps one out of 60 that
project sexually into.
Mm. But I do understand that they're only hurt in their own way. Mm. And
so I before just, you used to get a lot more sexual projections than that?
Yes.
But now you're getting a lot less. So that's telling you that something's changed.
Mm. And my thoughts of them are so much different now.
Yeah.
Because whether they're male or female, we are all.
Yeah, but see, now you're going all intellectual, I mean.
Yeah.
Let's step back down into the emotion. The real emotion that's still inside you is this emotion that men are bastards and you can't trust them. That's the core emotion. Mm. How does that relate to your dad?
Dad and I were like two peas in a pod. However, all he gave, well not all he gave me, but what he gave me mostly was negative strokes. Like, I only got attention when I'd done something wrong.
Right.
So I spent all my life when I was at home
did
with
he,
Dad.
Did he have this viewpoint towards you that, like, almost like he glorified you a bit? Like he treated you as the princess?
Oh, it put me on the pedestal.
Yeah, okay. There's a lot in that. You haven't actually given up your relationship with your father.
Well, then I married for 18 years and the same scenario happened again.
Yes, it will. And if you don't give up your relationship with your father, you're going to attract a man who's very similar to your father. In this case, it's a man who will worship you and treat you like a princess, but he won't actually really treat you like a princess. Like, there's this emotion that you're looking for from him. And so that's the kind of man you'll attract at the moment. And that's still in you, this emotion. Mm-hmm. This emotion is going to be about cutting the umbilical cord, if you like, between yourself and your father. Mm-hmm. And your father has this viewpoint of you too, that if you're sexual, then you're no longer his favoured daughter.
Oh.
See, a lot of men, with their daughters, they enter this kind of relationship that they don't have with their wives. The relationship with their wife is that, oh, my wife, I have sexual relations with my wife, so she's a woman. But there's this underlying emotion of that sexual relations are a bit dirty. So in their own mind, sometimes it's this concept of, my wife's actually a bit dirty, you know, because she's a woman I have sexual relations with. With their daughter, they then worship their daughter as the woman, the ideal woman. The daughter, they don't want to have sexual relations with anybody. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Because this is something that's happened to you.
Because when I was in my teenage years, you know, the males that were lurking around had to go through Dad before they got to me.
Exactly.
And they had to get Dad to
even your terminology is your dad's terminology. Your males lurking around. Now, what you need to do is allow yourself to feel this emotion that what you're... There's two things going on. Is you're looking for a man at the moment who will treat you like a princess. Of course, that's not your ideal relationship. Your ideal relationship is an equal relationship where you both have a passionate desire for each other, but not where one treats the other like higher than them. Mm. But the relationship with your father is that he treated you like higher than himself, but only in an asexual way. So in order to get his approval, you had to be asexual. You had to be without sexual desire. You follow me? So you have a deep shame about your own sexual desire, and also, therefore, a deep shame about any man who might have a sexual desire for you. The truth is, any relationship, the man's going to need to have a sexual desire for you.
Mm.
Otherwise, this relationship isn't going to work. Mm. But you're looking, actually, for a man that doesn't have a sexual desire for you.
Oh, no, honey.
No. Well, what did you say to these men?
Oh, but that was about 3 years ago.
It doesn't matter. It's an emotion inside of you still. What's the emotion? What did you say? You said you finished dancing. What did you say? They both came up to you. What did you say?
Well, I felt intimidated that And that's the first thing that cropped up in my head.
They both had a sexual desire.
Yeah.
You know what happened to the second man who stuck around? He just learned that he couldn't have it.
Yes.
Because you told him he couldn't have it.
Yeah.
So what do you want? You don't want him to have a sexual desire.
Well, no, I want them to love me for me, not for what else I've got.
Isn't part of that what is you?
Yes.
So,
but I don't want a man to want me for sex. I don't want that to be the major priority.
Ah, well, now you're talking about something different. That's not what you said to me, mate. You said if you're thinking about sex at all, this is an injury inside.
Oh.
See, what you're doing at the moment is you're justifying your statements to him. But that is closing you down from the emotions that cause those statements. And in closing down from the emotions, what you're not allowing yourself to do is actually realise that love is sex, sex is love, like that. Remember, at the moment in your mind, sex is over here, love is over there. In your mind, that's how it is.
And also what Mother said.
Yeah, what did she say?
That men were only after one thing, which I believed her.
Yeah.
So when I believed it, I manifested that, but and I thought it was true, so I pushed them away.
But there's an emotion inside of you that caused you to do that. And this is the problem you're facing in the last 10 years. The reason why you've had, shall we call it a dry spell? this leg's hurt. Like the reason why the derived spell is happening is because you've created it. You've created it.
Mm.
There's been men attracted to you, but they've been attracted to you sexually as well. And because you feel the sexual attraction is bad, you don't allow them to have a sexual attraction for you. What's wrong with a man having a sexual attraction for you?
Because I want them to love me.
But if love is sex, then a sexual attraction is part of any love that they are going to feel.
Mm.
You're basically asking them to cut down their erotic feelings for you and just have other feelings. So what is left is some principled feelings, some feelings that you're their sister, and so what do you finish up going to get? A man who treats you like he's your sister. Because you don't want the erotic feelings from him. Here, in your emotions, you don't want the erotic feelings. You think you do. No, you do not.
I won't know till I get into one, will I? Well,
you won't get into one. With this emotion, you won't get into one. Does that make sense? You will not attract a man with this emotion. Because any man who wants to be attracted to you will want to be attracted to you sexually as well as in these other ways. But you're already telling him from your soul, you don't even have to open your mouth. You're already telling him from your soul that you don't want a sexual connection. You say you do, but you do not. The reason why you don't is you've got these belief systems kicking in. Mm. These belief systems kicking in. Men are bastards. All they're going to do is want me for sex. That's anger. That's anger. That covers over a sadness.
Because a relationship, here you go.
Go on.
A relationship is not built on sex.
Well, this is where you justify yourself.
Ah.
A relationship. Sex is a good foundation for.
Okay, well, I'll go.
But remember, any time I've been talking about sex, I've been talking about sex with love. Except love and sex together. Mm. Now, what you're doing still is you're separating love from sex.
Mm.
You're saying that this man should be able to love me, then at some point in the future, he's going to love me sexually. Mm. That's not how it works.
So men get into their...
Not men. Everyone. This doesn't work for everyone, men and women.
Okay.
You are separating love from sex. And what you're doing is you're asking these men to separate love from sex as well. Right? Now, some of these men are not that injured. So they're not going to separate love from sex. Or if they do, they'll say, all right, I can love you like my sister, but I can't have sex with you. I'll find someone else to do that with. Are you going to end up in a relationship like that?
No.
So this is of your own creation due to that injury that is yet to heal.
Yeah.
And you justify it. You justify it by saying, men are bastards, you know, you can't really trust them, they've got to love me first before they have sex with me, and all these things. Mm. But the whole thing that is that you're already making a statement to them that they can't even love you before they begin. Because how they're going to love you is going to be in a complete way, which will include a sexual way. Does that make sense? So allow yourself to really get into those emotions about how angry you are about men being bastards who only want you for sex. Because there's some really deep core emotions underneath that. Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm.
And then you'll attract a man who does want your hot body and who wants you, the rest of you.
Mm.
Right? But he's not going to separate that. He's not going to say, oh, I'll love the rest of you first, and then 6 months later, I'll love your body then. He's not going to do that.
No, I wouldn't expect that.
No, that's what you do expect. That's what you told these men.
5 days later.
5 days later, you hopped in the sack with one of them, but that doesn't change anything. You told these men your belief. Right? And so 5 days later, one of them jumps in the sack with you.
And had passionate love.
Because
that word jump in the sack, it, to me, is unkind, unnice.
Oh, okay. So you have some emotional problems with me saying jump in the sack.
Yes.
Well, this man jumped in the sack with you 5 days later.
I couldn't.
He did.
I'd have to erase that word sack.
Oh, okay. To... It's not okay to have sex in a sack.
No.
You have to have it in bed.
In a nice setting.
Oh, okay. So I can't do a quick and dirty outside in the front lawn.
To me, no.
Oh.
Because you're only after me for sex.
Yeah.
I've got conditions, haven't I?
Very much so. And this is what's driving a lot of what's going on. You need to really strongly look at those conditions. There's a lot of conditions there. The truth is that, remember I said yesterday, that in the end you'll have a sexual relationship 24/7. Sleep state, awake state, won't really matter. There'll be sexual feelings going to it. It doesn't mean you'll be making love the entire time, but there'll be sexual feelings going between the two of you 24/7. At the moment, you couldn't cope with that. At the moment, you would feel that's dirty, shameful, not nice. You would feel quite a lot of different emotions about that, all judgments covering over some underlying core emotions, and you need to allow yourself to get to those core emotions. If you don't, what will happen is you'll keep on separating love from sex all the time.
And something else, like sometimes I think, oh, this is the one, you know, on the massage table, and oh, this is great. And I get all excited. Yes!
So who's pretending sexual?
Dream it.
And then I think they're going to ring me up. They're going to ring me up. And
they don't
come
back. I think
they're
stuck
now.
So I get all excited just to be let down.
Yeah, but see, there's a few other things going on here. You're very angry with me.
Yeah, you are. I believe
you. You believe me. You are. And
disappointed.
You're angry.
Okay.
You're angry. And it's okay to be angry. It's okay to recognise, yeah, I'm angry with men. I expect men to chase me. I won't do any chasing. I am not going to do any chasing. They're going to have to chase me. This is a feeling you have.
I have asked.
No, I see. See, this is the reason why I asked you right at the start. When you went dancing,
yeah.
Remember?
Yeah.
And when, like, I said, how many of them have you asked? And you said none.
No. But that's in the last fair. 6 months, I have.
Right.
I said, give me a ring. Tomorrow morning, we'll go for a walk up Mount Cooler.
Give me a ring. Chase me, and we'll go for a walk up
Mount Cooler. Because if I chase them,
yeah.
And they don't want,
yeah.
Then more feelings are going to come up.
Like what?
They don't want me. I'm no good.
And all you're doing is avoiding those feelings.
Hmm. So therefore, if I leave it up to them to come forward, then I know that they want to pursue something. I take some shortcuts.
That's not a shortcut. It's an avoidance of an emotion of rejection.
Yeah. Okay, well, I'll
need to feel that. You need to feel the emotion of rejection. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
But you are quite angry with them.
Uh-huh.
And you need to, but one of the reasons why you're angry is you want them to pursue you.
Because I can...
Yes or no? Do you want them to pursue you?
Well, yeah.
Okay.
Reason being...
You want to give me a reason?
Because if I ask them and they have a reasonable reason why they don't want to go out, because there's one bloke, Russell, I say, now, let's go and do something. Every time I ring, there's something happening and he can't come. So I think, well, if you want,
what do you
come
feel
to
well?
Me.
Well, what's this? What's this?
No.
Can you see your anger? Can you see your anger there?
Yeah.
Can you feel it? Mm-hmm. You need to feel it, because underneath that, there's some real strong feelings. Mm-hmm. Real strong feelings that you're going to be rejected and so forth. Allow yourself to feel those feelings. Because if you don't allow your feelings, what you're doing at the moment with a lot of these feelings with the opposite sex is you're justifying them. You're justifying them, giving yourself intellectual reasons of why you follow this pattern of behaviour. The truth is, the real reason why you follow this pattern of behaviour with men is because there's some underlying emotions that are quite strong about men, anger-based emotions about men that you need to release. And the only way to release them is to get to the underlying sadness, the underlying grief that's underneath that. That's the only way to release them. But if you don't even acknowledge your anger, you'll never get to it. You'll never get through your anger to that grief. Does that make sense? Mm-hmm. And if you don't do that, you're not going to attract men that you want. And when you do attract the kind of men you want, at the moment, sometimes you are attracting men who would be quite good for you, but you're actually rejecting them because they actually are projecting sexual energy at you at times, which you then assume means they're a bad man. Because you have these links between sex, men, nasty. You know, like, you have these links.
It's obviously still in me what I hear Mother said.
Yeah. Because atonement with God means also healing any problem you have with any of God's children. Now, if you have a problem, if you're a woman and if you have an anger feelings towards men, you have a problem with half of the world's population. That's a lot of children to be angry with, that you're actually angry with. And if you're a man and you're angry with women, you have a problem with half the world's population. And so can you see how it's not possible to connect to God because of that? It's obviously quite a big emotion. So we want to heal these emotions between the sexes, between we want to heal them so that we can be free of them. So that's very, very important. And in your case, there's a lot of stories that you tell yourself as justifications for your actions. And you will find that there is story after story after story that you can tell yourself. But the law of attraction is telling you the truth of how you feel. And if you don't recognize your own feelings that are out of harmony with love, any anger feeling, any stuff you feeling, any of those kind of feelings are all out of harmony with love. There's an emotional reason underneath them, and we need to find those emotional reasons if we want to heal our relationship with the opposite gender. Allow yourself to discover those emotional reasons. And Brian afterwards. Tissues are handy, by the way. There's just a box up there if you're worried about crying. It's right up there, so you've got to have it up there.
All right. I was molested by my brother when I was about 6 or 7.
How old was he?
He's 4 years older, so he was, 11-ish. Was that my law of attraction?
No, it's your mother's law of attraction. I can go into a long explanation. Do you want to be personal with it, or you want to be...
Just go with it, yeah.
Okay. Your mother had some sexual molestation events in her life, in her childhood, and she never healed them. And because of that, when you were born as a female, you absorbed all of these sexual, these events, and that caused that to be attracted in your family towards yourself as well. But it's actually your mother's law of attraction. So remember, you were there in the parenting discussion that we had, and you remember we talked about how the parents' emotions get absorbed by the child, which creates the child's law of attraction. And then the child acting out those things actually causes the parent to be triggered. So the whole point of the exercise, I suppose you can say, is that in the end, your mother, if she had dealt with her emotions about the molestation that occurred, in her own family towards herself, then what would have happened would be that you would never have attracted this event. Does that make sense? So it's your mother's law of attraction that created the event. The problem for you now is that you've got these feelings associated with the molestation. And so, and your mother still is not dealing with her feelings about it.
Hello.
Okay. So the question you need to ask yourself now is, right, am I going to wait for the rest of my life for mum to deal with it, or am I going to really start looking at all of the emotions involved with what went on? So you have some emotions of shame about what went on, some emotions that you feel like, how did maybe you encouraged it, is some emotions that you feel, and some other emotions about men generally. There's a feeling of anger towards men that you have that's quite strong as a result of those events. And so allow yourself to step into that anger, and you know, these are childhood anger that you need to express. So I'd be, again, getting some kind of way of dealing with the anger. Some people here have gotten long sticks of hard rubber hose and got something to beat with it, or some people have got a tennis racket and a baseball bat and a punching bag and worked out their anger that way. That's what you'll need to do to connect through the anger into that grief that you feel about those emotions. To deal with some of the sexual shame emotions, you'll probably first have to do things with regard to masturbation and look through and just start allowing yourself to feel sexual feelings and then feel the shame and guilt and type of feelings that come up with that. When you're then comfortable with all of that, you'll probably find yourself attracting a relationship, or if you're not in one already? Are you in one already? No. You will attract a relationship that will then help you work your way through those issues. But my suggestion is do some of that with yourself first and confront the issues sexually as well. And if you do that, you'll be able to heal it. And when you heal it, you won't have these big barriers up towards men that you currently have. And that will cause, you know, a man to be attracted into your life if that's your gender preference.
So, was it mum's issues that made my brother do that as well, or was it something else that made him?
It was probably your dad's issues that made your brother do that. But also your mum's issues caused any male in the family would automatically feel superior to a female in the family in your family. And you think about your siblings and you can see that straight away. You can see your father has that viewpoint, and your mother has this lesser person viewpoint. Your mother has quite a bit of anger with men still, though, of course, because of the things that have happened to her. So it's a combination of the emotions of your father and your mother. Your mother attracted your father because of her emotions and because of his emotions. So his emotions were domineering towards women, that women are there for my pleasure, and a combination of that situation created your brother's emotions, and that's what caused that abuse to occur. It's a very common thing in families for this to occur because of the combinations of emotions of the parents.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So I've still got to deal with that anger.
Still got to deal with the anger. Yeah. So allow yourself to step into the anger. Many women are so self-conscious about rage that they never allow themselves to step into it. And this is why many women who have been abused get depression, because they're shutting down their rage so much that they get into depression instead. And they become, not concerned or not feeling anything. You don't want to get into that state. So allow yourself to connect with the rage firstly, and then step underneath the rage, and then down into the sadness and the grief that's there and the shame that's there. But the rage has sort of been the way, your doorway into it. And next week we're going to have the session on anger, so that may help you.
I'll
just
be there.
Yeah, get into that. Yeah.
Can I ask one question related
sure.
to that? Were you able to scream while you were molested? Or did you have to?
No. Cry? One of the events actually happened, if I can go into detail, sitting at the table while the rest of the family were around there, he pretended to drop a pen and went under the table. So I was getting molested while my freaking family were right there. Yeah.
So you were not able to scream?
No.
Scream.
Yeah.
Scream now. Find a place and just scream your heart out and do it a lot.
Yeah. And in fact, that event that you just mentioned is a really good way that you connect with some of that anger. Can you see you have anger with mum and dad as well? Is that, you know, why didn't they notice this thing going on, you know? And you have some anger with your brother, of course, understanding that.
It's crippled my entire relationship with him.
Yeah.
I've basically not been able to look at him or talk to him ever since.
Of course.
Yeah. So, you know what? Yeah. 25 years later.
Yeah.
You know.
Yeah. Yeah. So, if you can work through those emotions, it's going to help you a lot. Yeah. You'll be surprised at how different you're going to feel. Okay. Yeah. It took me. I've had a lot of sexual abuse type emotions to work through from the first century experience of my soulmate that I took on when I entered in the second experience. And I've had quite a lot of them to work my way through. And it took me, without God, it took me around 4 or 5 years to work through them. And what I found during that time was that there were many people with sexual abuse issues that my law of attraction would bring into my life. And in fact, I was a member of an adult survivors of child abuse group for some time. And during that time, I found that the majority of people weren't connecting with their causal emotion in dealing with sexual abuse. They stayed in their rage. And this is what's damaging your life right now, is there's this rage there that's not letting, but you're in the rage. And it comes up quite easily. The key is if you can get into the rage, but then step down underneath that into the grief and the sadness that you feel. So there was a lot of sadness under that statement you just made earlier, a lot of sadness about how can my family not have known, what's going on there, you know. And to be frank with you, your mother and father wanted to ignore it, right? Your mother wanted to ignore it because it was to do with her own abuse issues. Your father wanted to do it because he felt that men could do that to women and to girls. So there are some core emotions there. The key is to not understand those emotions on the others, but that the others have, but actually let yourself feel your own emotions. If you do that with God, so if you talk to God about these emotions, you'll find you'll work through it really rapidly, and a year later you can be healed of the majority of those emotions.
A lot of fear with
Be
even trying to go down that path, because denial is great.
Well, it's not great.
Yeah, but it stops you from feeling it. Well,
yeah, but it stops you from experiencing the rest of your life. Like, this is the problem I had to face as well, was that did I want to experience the rest of my life or not? And if I did, I needed to heal those emotions. So the key is to allow yourself to go into the emotions. You will have a hard time allowing yourself, but if you talk to God about it and allow yourself to work through it, you find a year later you can be so free of all of these things that you'll wonder why you held on to them for so long. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So just allow yourself to work through it. Thank you.
Coming out story, because I felt left out a lot of the time. I know from my personal interactions with AJ that he loves me, but it's really difficult to translate some of the stories that you tell so that they make sense for me. Because of the whole left out thing, I seem to do that with my sex life as well. Ian's nodding, I can talk about. Like, I now have a partner of over 25 years who, because of his cancer, is impotent, so I miss out on the whole thing has come to this sex life where I don't have one, and it's that repeat of being left out. And there's a lot of sadness and there's a lot of anger, and I worked through a fair bit of it, but yeah, I don't know where that resentment comes from. I can't quite get to where that niggly thing with him a lot of the time and with the world in general comes from.
Now, you are quite mediumistic, right? So have you ever discussed these issues with some of your spirit friends to work out what's going on?
Yeah, well, after the last time about the sex thing I did, I talked with, I think it was John, and was John?
He's referring to the Apostle John, who's passed, and the Apostle John was a gay man. His soul is a male-male split, so he was a gay man on earth, and he experienced these experiences in John's case, for 33 years, he didn't have sex. So up until he was 33 years old, he didn't have sex because there were some religious beliefs he had, but on top of that, because he was a gay man with these religious beliefs, he felt that being gay was wrong. You know, there was this religious belief that it was wrong. And then he had a period of his life for 6 or 7 years where he started to allow himself to be what he was sexually, a gay man. And so John had a lot of feelings too, of feeling like he missed out on, like when you think about it, up until you're 33, there's a lot of your sexual life you're missing out, aren't you, in that time. So John had a lot of those kind of emotions. So certainly he'd feel quite attracted to talk to you about it. So what did John say about it?
Well, I got down to a whole pile of grief and it seemed like I had nowhere else to go.
Yeah.
So I sought God's presence, asked for divine love, and that was when he got really clear. I felt really clear my connection with John.
Yeah.
And as soon as I brought God into this, to my feeling, as soon as I could feel God, it seemed that a whole pile of the other spirits that were around, some of them got really pissed off with me because I'd sorted it out.
Yeah.
But a whole pile of them felt really relieved, and I could feel their relief.
Yeah.
And I mean, I've been a pioneer gay activist for a long time, and it just felt like here I am, here I go again.
Yeah.
Connecting with the love of for gay souls that God has, and having to go out and tell everybody that's what it was about, and being scared shitless, actually.
Brian, I reckon you're doing well. The truth is, the emotion underneath is this really, really deep emotion of grief. And you'll need to do more crying about it than you've done. And allow yourself to connect to that emotion of grief, of feeling missed out, feeling like, you know, you've been treated differently pretty much all your life. Some of it you've sought in anger, because you know, some of your activism has been driven by this underlying feeling of, I'm missing out and I need to change this. And what you need to do is allow yourself to connect to your emotion of missing out. And do you mind Ian, me speaking about your emotion regarding the impotence?
Yeah.
So with regard to the impotence, that again is a... Impotence is related, and by this applies to heterosexual or gay couples, it's immaterial. Impotence is related to a feeling of anger towards that gender. So in your case, Ian, it will be a feeling of anger towards men. It'll be related to how you either feel about yourself or how your father felt about you. And then, of course, the responding action in return that you felt towards him. Does that make sense?
Yeah. And if I relate the input of what Brian said about being left out.
Yeah, yeah. So the key thing for both of you to do is to start, like, experimenting with the sexual relationship in a way that's going to allow yourself to trigger these emotions. So the emotion that you're going to feel is this terrible emotion, I'm just not going to ever get what I want here, right? So allow yourself to really tune into that emotion and experience that emotion, because that's preventing you from moving forward and having a different law of attraction. For yourself, Ian, it's a different emotion of feeling a rage towards how you've been treated by men in particular. And because for you, there's been this change in you of recognizing that you're gay after living in a heterosexual relationship, there is this feeling of all of the men in the past that have turned all that off in you. Do you know what I mean? There's that, there's this anger towards the heterosexual male, if you like. Do you understand what I'm saying?
Yes, I'm afraid of a lot of men.
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm very aware of that.
Yeah, and
I just feel the violence.
That these heterosexual males are violent generally,
yeah.
Particularly towards any, if they're homophobic, definitely towards a male.
Yeah.
And so there's this strong, also there's this strong connection you have with your mother, which causes you to side on the side of the feminine. So whenever there is some kind of disagreement or argument between the male and the female, and this would have occurred when you were a child, you would have always sided with your mother.
Yeah, I did.
Does that make sense? Yeah. And actually felt a lot of anger and resentment towards your father. And it's that emotion that needs to be healed to allow you to have a complete sex life now. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
For yourself?
To deal with anger towards your father.
Yeah, allow yourself to tune into your anger with your father.
Yeah.
And really get into it, again, baseball bat bag or something, you know, something that allows you to physically express this anger.
I've given him a fair bit already.
Awesome. That's good. And then drop down into the grief that you feel about that situation. Like, what? So your father was teaching you about you. So in the end, the anger you feel towards your father, because you're a male, you're now even angry with yourself for being a male.
Yeah.
Does that make sense?
Yeah.
And so the key is then to tune into that emotional and allow yourself to feel that emotion and then step in underneath this grief, into this grief that you feel about being male. Because you feel a deep and terrible responsibility towards women, although you're a gay man.
Yeah.
And you feel this terrible, deep responsibility that you've done something to damage women. And men do things to damage women. And so you don't even like yourself being a man.
There was a time when I would have preferred to be a woman growing up. And my mother had stuff too. She lost three brothers. They died. My father died when she was only 17.
Yep.
And I think when she discovered she had a male fetus, she wasn't very happy. I think she much preferred to have a female one.
Yes.
And I picked up on that. So I am aware of that.
Yes.
That,
and a lot of homosexual male souls are attracted to women with male anger issues, right? And like John's mother was the same. She was almost, I can feel your mother and I can feel John's mother, and there's very, very similar emotions that they have towards men. And you took on those emotions about men, and then you focus them inwards towards yourself. So the key is to connect to a lot of that and allow itself to release that. Once that occurs, that'll sort out some issues for yourself sexually. And then if you can, during that time, because that's going to take a little time to do, obviously, if you can allow yourself to feel this terrible feeling that you feel, that you're not ever going to be satisfied sexually, that no matter what you do, you know, there's just going to be, you're just going to feel unfulfilled. And allow yourself to really tune into that emotion and release that emotion. You'll find once you get through that, you'll feel totally different. The other thing that there's an issue that what your question has brought up unknowingly to you that I'd like to discuss with everyone about love. So we'll do that in a second. But does that help any, Brian?
Thanks.
Brian's question has brought something up that I'd like to mention.
Is anybody cold? The aircon, Mr. Reynolds?
Well, can we get the aircon just a bit lower? Is everyone else? Well, someone wants a higher.
High temperature.
Cool. Well, we'll turn them off for a little while and then we're going to address. Obviously, everyone's temperature is different. And you know why everyone's temperature is different? Yeah. Once you deal with different emotions, you'll find that you'll be impervious to major temperature changes. But that's another story. All right. What Brian's question has brought up is another issue, and it's something that I just want to discuss with you in this issue, because what we're often doing in our relationships is we're substituting things. Now, what I mean by that is, let's say, so here's God. God has a really specific love for you, right? Which we've called the divine love, right? So God's love for you, the divine love. The way God created you, so here's your soul. The way God created you was that there is this natural inclination for the soul to need this love. So right from the soul's inception, God created this soul to seek God, but using its own will. But what most of us do is this particular love we never obtain because we don't know how to seek it. And so instead what often happens is that we start then substituting the seeking of that love for the seeking of other loves, loves from other souls. Does that make sense? So if I'm a male, let's say I start seeking. And what I finish up doing is I start expecting this person to substitute the role of God in my life. Can you see what I'm saying? From a love-based perspective. Now, I've said to you over and over that God is not injured with love. So God can always love you perfectly. God is also your true parent. Now, the problem is, for many of us, is we're seeking our love. This person may be a female parent, for example. We might be seeking a certain type of love from a female parent that in reality we should be seeking from God. And the flaw in the whole system, I suppose you could say, from our parents' perspective, is they want us to love us, to love them. You know what I mean? So how many of you have actually thought about having a child so the child would love you? I actually heard a lady once on Oprah say that. Oprah asked her, why did she have a child? She said, I wanted someone to love me. She has four children. She wanted a fifth and her husband doesn't want any more. And so she was going to leave her husband to have another man who would let her have another child, is the way she saw it. And what was she doing? She was actually living her life through her children. Right? And what that teaches those children is that they have to live their life through their parent. Right? So what happens in a dynamic sense for most of us is that we finish up having this dynamic where either our mother or our father, so on this side we've got our father. So that's our father. Our earthly father. This is our mother. We start seeking emotions from them that really we need to be seeking from God. So we go through this process of substitution. It's a very, very damaging process to us emotionally. And it's also a very damaging process to us sexually. Because we start getting hooked sexually into our parents. Now what I mean by that is, if our father disapproves, let's say I'm a male, and I'm hooked into my father's emotions. If my father disapproves of the kind of woman I want to go out with, I won't go out with her. Do you see? Because it doesn't get my father's approval. And that causes huge problems here on earth. Often in the Middle East, the father doesn't approve of the woman, and so the male, the child, marries the woman the father does approve of, and doesn't have any fulfilling sex life or any other life with her because all he wants is the other woman that he couldn't have. Do you see what I'm saying? This happens all the time in our relationships. And if I am hooked into my father or my mother or both in terms of their approval and their acceptance, what I'm going to do is I'm going to project those approval and acceptance through my desire. So in fact, down the track, I'll actually stop feeling a desire for the person I would normally be desiring, and I'll actually want to try to manufacture a desire for the person they approve of. And it even gets worse than that. What eventually happens is that if I'm a female, I'll attract a man exactly like my father, or the mirror opposite of him, as a result of these emotions. Or if I'm a woman, I'll attract a man who's exactly like, sorry, I'll attract, what did I say first? I think I said it the wrong way around. If I'm a woman, I'll attract a man who's either the mirror opposite of my father or the same, almost identical to my father. If I'm a man, I'll attract a woman who's either the mirror opposite of my mother or identical to my mother. Now, to give you an illustration of how that happened with me, I was only attracted to a woman of a certain type until I dealt with these emotions. So the type of woman that I was attracted to at that time was a woman that was in the 5 foot to 5 foot four bracket, right? Slim, slight, you know, with a figure, not large, not too skinny, but with a figure. And I also had some first century things mixed in it, so they had to have dark hair and they had to have certain eyes, whatever else. So lots of physical things, not much soul-based stuff going on, lots of physical things going on. And then they also had to have, emotionally, a feeling that they'd been hurt as a child. They had to have a feeling of some kind of abuse from a male, whether it be alcohol abuse or sexual abuse or whatever, from a male. They had to have a number of different other issues before I would feel attracted to them. Because this is what I was doing. I was feeling the attraction through the type of person or the soul of my mother, if you like, the type of person my mother was. Once I worked through all of those emotions, it was really interesting because I didn't know what I was attracted to after that. I didn't have any list in my mind anymore of what my woman would look like or be like or feel like or in terms of her appearance and in terms of emotions. Does that make sense? And once that occurred, then I could attract my soulmate. Right? Because before that time, all I was doing was just not attracting anyone who would have been anything like my soulmate. And so now, my soulmate, Mary, is beautiful and tall, and just I find her really elegant and classy. And that wasn't the type of woman generally that I would have been attracted to before. I would have been scared of Mary before. Because the type of woman would have been the type of woman that she needed to be feeling a bit downtrodden. And I needed to be the helper and the carer and all these other things. So I could list 100 of these emotions that I had, right? And after working through them all, it was totally different in terms of what my attraction was. So this is why it's so important to break, if you like, the umbilical cord that we often have between ourselves and our parents in terms of the definition of the ideal partner. Does that make sense to everyone? It's a very big thing to go through. It's also a very powerful thing to go through in terms of approval. If your father or your mother disapproves of who you're choosing, look really deeply at why you're so hooked into their approval. Because that's your law of attraction. Does that make sense? So look very deeply into why you're seeking the approval of your mother or father in your relationship. You'll find even that you might even be making love to the person that you're with and feeling the disapproval of your parents at the same time. And the truth is, if they are asleep in the sleep state, many times they'll actually be there in the sleep state watching you and projecting at you. Right? So while you stay hooked into those parents, they are going to be present every time you make love to this person, like if they can be, and projecting at you anger and resentment and no, this is wrong, this is... And do you think that's going to make you feel great when you're having sex with that person? Of course not, right? And so you'll feel drawn into running away from the relationship. Now, so I've brought up two issues there. One issue is don't substitute love for other love. If you need God's love, seek God's love. In fact, God's love is the only love that is going to be completely fulfilling and is without injury. So seek that first. Then with regard to your relationships, seek their love, but not through this substitution process of what your parents think or feel. If you do not break what your parents think or feel away from you emotionally, you will keep investing in their approval in every relationship until you die, which is not a very good thing to do. And you will also encourage them, if they're in the sleep state or in the spirit state, you'll be encouraging them to interfere with your life. by having this feeling that you've got to seek their approval in your relationship. Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm.
And that is definitely going to interfere with your sex life, trust me. It's definitely going to interfere.
Angel, you mentioned cutting the umbilical cord with your parents. How do you go about doing that?
It's about dealing with the emotion of why you're so hooked into their approval. So for instance, if I'm a male child and I want my mother's approval, the way that I got my mother's approval was whenever she needed any help, I was the male, not dad, but I was the male who gave her the approval she needed. Does that make sense? So if she felt bad about herself, I'd be the one giving her a hug. So only little, you know, you're only 4, 5, 6, 7 years of age trying to cheer your mum up, for example. So these are all things that have been established from a young age. So if you find yourself, for example, things like you don't want to tell your mother the truth, you don't want to, there's a, you have an umbilical cord connection still with her, if that's the case, if you do not want to tell her the truth. If you're afraid of what her reaction will be to the truth, you have a link that's happening that needs to be broken. If you're, like in my case, needing to always, like, nurture her. So I would also act that out with all of my partnerships, but I also needed to still continue nurturing my mother, so I had to stop doing that. And I had to allow the emotion that was underneath that to surface and feel it, which was a deep need for my mother's approval. Ironically, I often attracted my mother's disapproval as a result. And so like things like my mother would come home, and because I was quite a clever and intelligent child, she would come home and test me with things all the time to see whether I had the answer or not. And if I didn't have the answer, I could feel the projection of, I can feel, mum felt good about herself if I didn't have the answer. Does that make sense? So I became invested in not having the answer. Because the only way to get her approval was to not be able to tell her what the answer was. Does that make sense? So I actually started shutting down my cleverness, if you like, and so much so that around people, I would never tell them what I did at school. In fact, my parents hardly ever knew at times even what marks or grades I got as a result, just in order to get their approval.
Okay. Is it all about trying to seek love and approval?
And with our parents, there's often this addiction that we have. We don't feel loved. We never felt loved by them in many cases, and we're constantly trying to get their love. We're constantly trying to do anything to get that love from them. Including if that means I meet a female, or, you know, I meet a man or a woman who I want to have a relationship with, and mum and dad don't agree, so I don't have the relationship. It even goes down that far.
Or if you want to rebel and do the opposite.
It's one of the two. It's always one of the two, generally. If you want to rebel and do the opposite, you are still hooked in to your parents' emotions. But all you're doing is doing the opposite, to rebel against them. But you're still hooked into them, so it's not healed, if that makes sense. Same goes. Remember, in your relationships and in your sexual relationships too, how like if I'm a male, how my father feels about himself will affect me. If I'm a male, how my mother feels about men will affect me. Does that make sense? So I need to look at both sexes and how they feel about men. One will be about how my dad feels about himself. The other one, for me, will be about how my mother feels about men. If I'm a woman, how my mother feels about herself will affect how I feel about myself. And how my father feels about women will affect how I feel about myself. Does that make sense to everyone? And we need to allow ourselves to heal these emotions. When you heal these emotions, you will no longer have defined things in your mind as a list of all of the required attributes that the ideal partner is going to be. And honestly, we need to get rid of that, because none of that is soul. None of that soul-based stuff. It's all injuries or physical attributes. So this is why many of us feel like, you know, if you look at a pattern in your life and you see every man you were attracted to was of a certain type of physical structure, a certain type of emotional person, then that's telling you, in fact, and if you can relate that to either being the opposite of your dad or the same as your dad, then you haven't disconnected emotionally from your dad. And to be frank, you haven't disconnected sexually from your dad either. Right? So there's been some kind of sexual connection with your dad that you need to disconnect from as well. Once you disconnect from them, you will not. You will have a much, much wider viewpoint of what's acceptable in terms of even physical, but also emotional and spiritual nature, and you will allow that to be present.
If that parent then passes over, does that alter?
Doesn't alter anything.
It doesn't happen.
In fact, in some cases, it intensifies the feelings. The reason why is that mother or father can now be with you, constantly monitoring you, whereas before, they couldn't do that. So there was one lady I knew whose stepmother, who she grew up with from the time she was three, was with her 24/7 monitoring who she was getting involved with, what kind of person she was, what kind of things she did, and every time stepmum disagreed, and there was a big anger relationship between the two of them, any time stepmum disagreed, she tried to impact upon her stepdaughter physically. The stepdaughter was on earth, the mother's in the spirit world. So yeah, when they pass, they can even have a greater emotional feeling towards
because they're available.
Well, the other issue too is often we lie to our parents about what we're doing. We know that mum, for instance, doesn't like this kind of a guy, you know, motorcycle riding, you know, long hair sort of guy. And that's the guy I happen to be going out with this week, right? So if mum had passed, what's she going to be doing? She's going to be wanting to try to break up the relationship, cause all sorts of problems, right? That's what she's going to be trying to do if she's invested in her daughter and her daughter is still worried about how her mum feels. Now, if you do not want to tell your parents the truth about how you feel, you are still invested in them emotionally. It's quite simple. If you do not want to be yourself in front of your parents, you are still invested in them emotionally. No matter what age you are, you're invested in them emotionally.
So how do you cut that?
By feeling your emotional reasons as to why you do that. So why am I still wanting to protect my mother? Why do I still want my father's approval? I need to feel those emotions. Once I feel and release those emotions, I will no longer be seeking my father's approval or to protect my mother. This is what I'm listing you my emotions, right? So I won't try to do that anymore. And once I don't try to do that anymore, I've cut those linkages. And once I've cut those linkages, I can now be myself. And to be frank, you'll never have a fantastic sexual relationship with someone unless you've already learned to be yourself.
Mm-hmm. Hi, Jake. If they're, you know, would you say that the father's checking out your partner and that all the time through the spirit world, is that even when they're up in the spheres, or is that only when they're earthbound? Or
when they're earthbound and in the first sphere, they'll do this. When they get to the second, third, fourth spheres, they start dropping off the emotions of judgment. So because they're in a higher state of love themselves. So by the time they get the fifth, sixth sphere, they generally wouldn't be doing this. And if they were a celestial spirit, they certainly would not be doing this at all. So you'll often find, even to do with race, there might be selections that you feel impelled to make based on these linkages, even if your parents have passed. And a lot of times that is your parents' emotions that you're listening to, because you couldn't break away from those emotions when you're on Earth, when they were on Earth. You still have the linkage when they've passed. So my suggestion is look really, really, if your parents are alive on Earth, or even if they've passed, but especially if they're alive on Earth, if you still have an investment with them, look really sincerely at what's going on, because it will help you a lot in working through you being yourself. And you loving yourself is one of the most important things with regard to your connection with God. God wants you to be your pristine self. Your parents have an emotional investment in you being something different, generally. Right? So allow yourself to see the emotional, the real parent is the God, of course, is my real parent. The real parent is the one who can love me completely. While I'm trying to substitute that love with the love of my parents, in other words, while I'm trying to get love from my parents and not get love from my real parent, I'm going to enter into emotional transactions that caused me lots and lots of personal damage.
Is there any way that you can't sort of get a spirit-proof room or anything?
A spirit-proof room. You don't want a spirit-proof room. The truth is if you feel your parents with you in a decision that you're making and you feel that I need, what would my mum do or what would my dad do in that situation, then what we need to do is start saying, all right, this is my law of attraction. My law of attraction is telling me that I'm still invested in my parents' emotions. Why am I, what am I wanting to do? I want their approval. So you'd sit down. If mum had passed, you'd sit down and say, mum, I'm still looking for your approval. Do you think if you loved me, you would, wouldn't you already approve of me? So why am I still, you know, why am I still looking for your approval?
I mean, it's a bit scary
to think
they're all sitting around watching you.
Yeah, they're all sitting around watching. Now, as they progress to higher levels of love, there's less and less of that kind of interference. And as they, if they become a celestial spirit, there's no interference whatsoever. All that they're present is just helping you whenever you want help. But if they're in the first sphere, which many of your parents will be if they've passed, or if they've just passed, generally they will be in the first sphere, what will happen is that there will be this strong intention of theirs to try and look after you in their way, which happens to be the most unloving way possible, that they probably tried when they're on Earth, which you didn't feel too good about when they're on Earth, right? And so the key is for you to break these emotional ties with them. Now, I don't mean that you don't love them. That's not what I'm saying. What I'm saying is you, if you have emotional investments in gaining their approval and acceptance, or you have emotional investments in doing what they suggest to you, it is always going to lead to future issues with you, whether they have passed or they're alive on Earth still.
Okay.
Can I just ask whether everyone gets that? Because it's really important to understand that. And by the way, there are big sexual issues involved in that. Can you see why? You imagine, like, if your father doesn't approve of the person you feel horny for, do you think you're going to still feel horny for them? Now, unless you've got a rebellion thing going on with your father, you will if you have a rebellion thing going on with your father. But if you have a desire for his approval and acceptance, don't you think you're going to shut down any sexual feeling you had for that person? And it applies to mother too, son, and also can be female, like can be daughter with mother. If mother doesn't approve of this man that I'm with, and I'm invested in getting my mother's approval, how am I going to feel about this man? Aren't I going to be shutting myself down, closing myself down, causing myself to be pushed out of the way for the sake of so-called love of my parent, which is of course not loving the parent. Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Okay. And we need to use the mic for these questions. So if we go to come to Nina for this.
Regarding the parent thing, I feel that my daughter's clearly always wanting my approval.
Mm-hmm.
Can I have some help with that? Because
if your children are wanting your approval, it's because when you were younger and they were younger, you taught them that they had to have your approval before they did anything. So the best thing you can do now is sit down with your child and say, and start talking to them about the fact that, you know, and again, don't do this if you don't feel it. You need to first feel that you have done the wrong thing by wanting them to come to you for approval all the time. And once you feel that, you'll be able to sit down with your child and say, look, I can see how I've done the wrong thing. What I've done is I've made my love for you dependent upon you wanting my approval. Or you know, I only approved of you when you did what I wanted. And what I'm going to work through now, and I promise you I'm going to work through this now, I'm going to work through you giving you my approval no matter what you choose to do. And so whenever you come to me seeking for my approval, I'm going to say, please don't seek for my approval. What do you want? Right? Now, you can say all of that, but if you get angry with them for doing something that they wanted to do, you don't mean it. And you need to look at that emotionally. So as a parent, we need to say to ourselves, all right, if I'm upset about my son, daughter not doing something that I feel approving of, then there is an emotion in me where I'm invested in my child. I'm invested in them emotionally, and I am out of harmony with love doing that. They are allowed to have their free will, and if I'm not encouraging their free will and allowing and accepting of them and loving them, whatever choice they make, then I am out of harmony with love. And I'm saying even whatever choice they make, even if the choice happens to be go down to a, you know, car yard and steal a car and drive it off into the sunset, I will still love them. My love for them won't change just because they've done something that other people or even myself will feel is the wrong thing. My love for them won't change. Does that make sense?
It does, and I feel I've started that process.
Yeah, yep, that's good. And just go back there.
Thank you. I think you clarified a few issues for me today, and certainly what the other people have said has helped as well. I find myself on the other end of that, where I don't, and as a child, as a teenager, I remember not wanting approval, as in I just wanted to feel free and being constantly badgered and told that I must fit the mould, I must have people's approval, I must ask permission, and if I didn't check with approval first, I was wrong, I was out there, I was rebellious, and I deserved everything that really bad had happened to me.
Yep.
And I sort of feel like I'm on the other end of that, and I have identified, I guess, almost rage at my mother.
Yes.
Because it was her telling me that
what
I
to do constantly.
And I didn't want to inform, I just want to be a free spirit, to be myself.
Yeah.
And I had to, you know, not be this, not be that, don't be like that, don't be like this, wash your emotions down, don't get angry, don't get upset, all of the things that I just wanted to feel and be me.
Yeah.
So it's sort of almost like the opposite end of what you're saying. There's not a need for approval, it's a need for just leave me alone. I just want to be myself.
Yeah, and yeah, and what's happened for yourself, though, is the flip side of the need for approval, and that is a deep anger and rage that you didn't get their approval by doing anything, by just being yourself. You see, whenever our free will is impacted, we are going to get upset. Now, the first bit of upset we generally get is sad, you know, grief. We feel grief, in other words. But our parents don't let us feel that generally. What instead they want us to feel is to do exactly what they want. So they shut down that sadness as well that we feel. See, that sadness is their law of attraction. Their law of attraction for the suppression of our own childhood emotion of wanting to be free. Does that make sense? So their law of attraction is our child is crying because you're not letting them, like my child is crying because I'm not letting him or her be free. Right? Now the crying, their tears should affect my heart. And make me look at what I'm doing to create their tears. But you know what happens in most cases? What happens is we make them suppress their tears, don't we? No, you can't cry. I'm telling you, you've got to do what I say, and you cannot cry about it. You cry about it, I'll give you something to cry about it. Right? So what we do then is we smack them for crying. Or, you know, for drama queening the whole situation, right? Which then creates anger, and they get angry, and they get rebellious. And by the time they're a teenager, do you think they want to hear anything I've got to say? Of course not. And so you will often find the flip side of these things happening. So on the side, the flip side is this deep rebellious sort of an anger, and this deep anger and rage with a parent shutting down free will. Or on the other side, you'll get to be a person who's doing whatever mum and dad wants in this vain attempt to get their approval constantly.
It didn't really matter to me like that. It never really mattered to me. I don't ever remember having a conscious thought about whether or not if I did well on exams or not. It only mattered to me.
Yes,
they
but...
They wouldn't stop at me because it didn't matter to them.
But your anger at the moment is saying that you are still connected to them. Unless you release the rage, you will remain connected to them in the opposite sense.
Yep. I get that.
Yep.
And I don't think I've ever really understood that, because the anger is about them trying to manipulate me.
Totally. Yep.
And I didn't let it happen, and it resulted in me being
punished,
isolated from the rest of the family.
Exactly.
Well, who gives a shit?
Yeah. But you do. There is a deep sadness underneath that. of you, that shouldn't have happened. There's this deep sadness in you about that. And that's what will be under the rage.
Well, I can see that. It's just all right. Well, there wasn't trouble needing approval. I was just needing to be...
Well, in the end, it's a need to be loved. All of us need to be loved. And in fact, that's what our parents should be teaching us, what love really is. And your parents taught you something that you couldn't accept, and that is that love is getting their approval all the time.
It's conditional.
And it's conditional, and which is true. You knew more about love than your parents knew in that situation. But there is a deep rage about the fact that they didn't actually love you. That's still there within that needs to be felt and allowed to be felt. And when you release that, you won't even feel the rebellious anger towards them anymore. You won't feel the rage towards them anymore. You do feel it, because I can feel it in you. But allow yourself to connect to it. Don't be afraid of it. Don't tell yourself that it's not there anymore when it is there still defining you. Allow yourself to see what's underneath and allow yourself to connect to it. Let yourself see, you knew the truth when you were a child. It was suppressed, and the way you deal with the suppression, which is the way many deal with it, is by rebelling against the suppression. Others do whatever the suppression is. It depends on our personality as to which one we will do, generally. Many of us have rebelled, some of us, or many of us, will go down the other track of doing whatever we can do to get their approval. That's the track I took. Either one of them creates a link with our parent that until we release those emotions, will never be broken. If that makes sense. Okay, Carol, thanks. Mike, thanks. Thanks, Michael, for doing our mic. It's got a poetic thing about that. Mm-hmm. And it's down here, Carol.
AJ, I've talked to a lot of people who have, I've had people talk to me about that have lost a spouse who they've been deeply in love with,
mm-hmm.
and they've died. And they've sometimes been quite young people,
mm-hmm.
and they've said to me, you know, is it all right if I have take another love? And I don't know what to say. What is the case? Because in the Paget messages, it seems that James Paget's wife doesn't want him to look at anybody else. She says, just keep loving me, you know. So what is the situation?
Many people, when they pass, if they are deeply in love with a person on earth, when they pass, they will still feel that same love they had. The love doesn't die with their death, right? So they still have the feeling of love. However, the hard thing for the person on earth is that they don't see the person anymore. They feel like they can't connect with the person anymore. Of course, if they were more connected spiritually, they'd still feel that love and that transaction could continue, right? Now, there is no harm in the person on earth getting to be in love with another person whatsoever. The difference for the Paget messages was that James Paget knew that she was his soulmate, and he knew he was her soulmate, right? So they both knew they were soulmates. And so she had a deep desire to have his love for herself only. And that's what you do when you're a soulmate. You do have a deep desire for just their love and no one else's love. However, Paget did remarry. Yeah. And he remarried because he felt the need to have, you know, this connection, this physical connection with somebody. Because there was a period later in his life after the Paget messages was written, just before his death, that it was about 2 or 3 years before his death, but he remarried. And he wanted to remarry for other reasons. There were emotional reasons that he wasn't facing within himself. But he wanted to remarry. And that actually had the effect of detuning him a little from the soulmate relationship. Does that make sense? Now, what you choose to do is totally up to you. Now, Helen, Paget's wife, was okay with him remarrying. She would have preferred for him to stay single because that way she could have a closer connection with him. Right? But let's say she wasn't a celestial spirit. Like, she was a celestial spirit at the time when he did this. But let's say she wasn't. Let's say she was a first fear spirit. She might put a lot of pressure on him to maintain the relationship. And she may try to muddy the waters with the new partner that comes along, and she'll try and stir up trouble, and you know what I mean? And this often does happen in the spirit world, where different people who have passed feel really upset that the man's taken a new husband or wife or lover within 6 to 12 months of their passing. Right? And there's a lot of anger sometimes that gets presented, and a lot of fear, you know, a lot of projections that come from the spirit world, which cause the people to go through guilt, a feeling of guilt that I've done that.
How do
we interfere? We needing to change that? Yep. So let's just change that. We need to have a break, probably. How's everyone? Feeling good? That wasn't me putting that up, by the way. But there's been a lot of accusations at me about being a cult leader. I find them very interesting. I'm not very good at it. Being a cult leader, I mean. But I definitely agree with the practicing safe sex. But anyway, that was your creation as a bride. He doesn't want to acknowledge it.